So now the next step is poles. And as a motivation, why do we need poles? As a motivation, let's have a look again at the frequency response of our zero. So the zero creates a very, very shallow dip here. Yeah, so that's the dip created by a zero. So the question is there a way of making the slope steeper? The solution to this here is put a resonance on omega zero. So the resonance generates something like that. So we hope that the resonance here, if we're putting the resonance at omega zero here, that this improves our response here. And the resonance at omega zero, this is created by an IIR filter or pole. So that's the next step, what we're going to do now. So what we are creating is now a pole, second order, and it acts as a bandpass or resonator. And remember, our definition of that was the following. So now we are first ignoring the FIR part here and just working with the pole. So 1 minus and then E to J omega 0 Z to minus 1, and then we multiply this here 1 minus R E to minus J omega 0 Z to minus 1. Now we've got something similar to the zeros, but we've got this R here in addition to this. So this defines the radius of the pole in polar coordinates. So we've got this also here. And still we've got here the E to J omega and E to minus J omega. So this gives us complex conjugate pole. So here and here. But with the addition is that this radius is defined here. So this means, so if this is our unit circle here, so this is here 1 and this is 1, so this is real and this is imaginary, that we now define a pole here and a pole here. It's not really fitting. So that's our pole here. And that this is here our radius. And then we're defining here our angle omega zero. And this is here minus omega zero as this angle here. And so now we've got here two parameters in this case. So a radius here, and we have our angle omega zero here. So now we need to explore this scenario here. So we can now just write our transfer function again out in real terms here. So the same what we've done before in the, with the zeros. So that's the same idea. So we just need to squeeze in the R here, but otherwise it's obviously exactly the same. So we don't need to spell this out at length. So that's our function now with real coefficients here. So that's our first coefficient here. Should take the minus sign with me here. So that's the second coefficient here. And this is here the third coefficient here. So now, so how does the data flow diagram looks like? And we know with IR filters we need to be careful here with this feedback here. So just as an exercise, let's do this again, that we know how this works here. So the idea is that we're actually multiplying the x of z against the h of z, and we're getting our y of z. So this means here in this case our x of z is multiplied by 1 over, and then we've got here the 1 minus 2r cosine omega 0 z2 minus 1 plus r square z2 minus 2. And this is y of z. And now we know in order to solve this, we just multiply the whole thing to the other side. So we're getting then x of z is equals to y of z, and then multiplied this here minus by y of z 2r cosine omega 0, that's our factor, z2 minus 1, and then plus y of z r square z2 minus 2. So in order to get the output now, y of z, we just shovel these two terms over, because these are our delayed terms here. X of z now is then plus y of z 2r cosine omega 0 z2 minus 1, and then minus y of z r square z2 minus 2. So we see the sine inversion here, and then this gives us here y of z as an output. Okay, so as a data flow diagram, if I manage to squeeze this in here, we have a summation node here, and then we've got a delay step, and we have another delay step here. So now what we need to do is we need to, the first delayed one here, we multiply this with 2r cosine omega 0 and feed this back. So like this, and we multiply this here by 2r cosine omega 0. And so we see the sine is inverted. And so now in the second step here, we need to multiply the delayed y of z by two time steps by r square and subtracting this. So we need to send this here back. We need to multiply this here with minus r square. And this is essentially our IR filter here. So that's x of n. What's now a bit of a squeeze here is getting the output out here. So that's our output signal here, and this is here our y of n. But we still hear how the circuit diagram works, so we have now a recursive filter we need to deal with. So now again the question is, so what is the frequency response? Again, we just go back to our original function here, and we directly see what this filter does. So 1 minus r e to j omega 0, and then z to minus 1, and we multiply this as 1 minus r to e to minus j omega 0 z to minus 1. Again, we need to write e to j omega, and then write 1 minus r e to j omega 0, and then this is e to minus j omega 0, and then this is here 1 minus r e to minus j omega 0, and then this is e to minus j omega. This is not omega 0, this is an omega. If r is nearly 1, then this means that this term here approaches one for omega equals omega 0. So this means that the whole term here goes towards infinity. So the same applies obviously for the other side here. So if r is close to 1, and at the same time and omega equals to minus omega 0, then this means this here goes towards infinity. So this means we have something like a resonance here. And so if you plot this here in our frequency spectrum, that's our omega 0, that's our minus omega 0, this is omega. This is here our function h of e to j omega. Then what we get is here some kind of peak, and this is obviously dependent on the r factor here. Complex conjugate poles. And so complex conjugate poles, so in this case here, let's just draw this a bit larger. So we've got here our radius, and then here we've got our omega here, or omega 0, and then we've got the same pole, so usually drawn as a cross. Then we've got the same omega also here, so that's the same. So real imaginary. And so what complex conjugate poles do is they are creating a resonance at omega 0. And so the radius r determines how strong the resonance is, and obviously the system is only stable if r is smaller than 1. So see lecture about stability. And so in the in the time domain, so R determines the decay of the oscillation. Yeah, so if R is against 1, it oscillates forever, and if R is small, then the oscillation decays quickly.